This week, a grand jury in Ferguson, Missouri, chose not to indict police officer Darren Wilson in the death of a black teenager, Michael Brown. And Defense Secretary Chuck Hagel announced his resignation. For that and more, we turn to the analysis of Shields and Brooks. That is syndicated columnist Mark Shields and New York Times columnist David Brooks. We welcome you both on this day after Thanksgiving. So, Mark, the aftermath, the reaction to the Ferguson grand jury decision not to indict, we're watching reaction all over the country. What does it say about the state of race relations in this country today?
I don't know if it says as much about the state of race relations as it certainly does about race perceptions. There were two different Americas when it comes, for example, to the performance of the police. A majority of Americans, white Americans, strong majority, believe that the police treat everybody the same. Black Americans do not see that the case. They see that blacks that are treated disproportionately with greater force than our whites. There is a less confidence in the police on the part of blacks than there is in whites. And Judy, it's borne out by the numbers in Ferguson. 86%. It's a city that's 2/3 black. Mm-hmm. Of the 53 officers on the police force, three of them are non-white. And 86% of all the traffic stops were black motorists. So there is that sense, the widening gap. I think we were all euphoric in 2008, the election of the first African-American president, who has since been reelected with a majority, that somehow race relations in the country have been resolved and were over as an open wound. But on something like police treatment of black Americans, it obviously is two different countries.
Is it mostly, David, about perception and of how people are treated by law enforcement?
I think a little, yes, obviously, but not so much from the grand jury. I thought the grand jury report it angered a lot of people, but I think it introduced a note of ambiguity to more people because it really did put some facts in front of the case. And I think it made us cautious. I think one of the things it did for a lot of people is made them separate the episode from the condition. Now, the episode was what actually happened that night between Wilson and Brown. And I think we learned that Brown definitely went into the car, tried to seize the officer's gun. And that makes it very hard to indict the police officer in those circumstances. We don't know whether Wilson was attacking or whether Brown was attacking Wilson when the final shots were fired. But we knew now that it was a pretty ambiguous confrontation there, which probably made conviction impossible. So we have some facts about the episode. The larger conditions, I think we still have a lot to say about, which is that there's the legacy of distrust, the legacy of racism, the impact of poverty, the impact of inequality. And I think what's happened with the larger condition is the distinct issue of civil rights has become embedded in a whole series of social problems having to do with poverty, having to do with concentrated poverty, having to do with family structure, having to do with schools, having to do with disappearing jobs. And it's become a lot thornier. And so what was a very simple good versus bad civil rights story has become a much more complicated domestic policy story, really.
Mark, is it possible? I was going
to. I just want to say, you know, David makes a good point, but I think that the difference is seen in the way he presented it. Whites look at this individual episode and the grand jury report, and I think the points he makes are absolutely valid ones. But blacks, I think, have an understandable tendency to look at it as a pattern. In other words, there's a presumption on the part of blacks that they're not going to be treated as well or as fairly when dealing with the police. I think that's a major, major gulf. And make no mistake about it, Judy, the traditional ladder of when America gets a cold economically, black America gets pneumonia. And the traditional road up through factory jobs, manufacturing jobs, that so many African Americans have used to climb into the middle class and then educate their children in college, is no longer available. It's no longer available for white working class Americans either. So, I mean, the changed economy has compounded the problem.
We've heard go ahead, David. Go ahead. I want you both.
If I could just add on that. Yeah, I think it's compounded the problem economically and led to the widening inequality. Mm-hmm. It's also led, I think, for whites and blacks and Hispanics as well, to a widening sense of disrespect. that not only is there no opportunity, but they're being disrespected by people with authorities. And that's especially true with African Americans because of the legacy, the historical legacy of racism in this country. And it does make me think that across a range of issues, but especially law enforcement issues, we have two models, the sort of dominant force model, which is what the police are used to using, and a model that gives much more emphasis on respecting people in the community, which is probably a little less aggressive sometimes and which may be risky. But in the long run, that more respectful model may be the stronger and the healthier model for the communities.
It's interesting. We've been hearing from some viewers this week who are saying they don't think the news media is reflecting the whole spectrum of the position that law enforcement is in. But, Mark, I guess my question, the next question for me is, can this country have a constructive conversation about this?
You know, I hope we can, Judy. I mean, I think we're capable of it if we, I mean, acknowledging right up front, I mean, that police officers have a tough job. I mean, when they get a 911 call or just any kind of a call, they're going into a situation that's laden and fraught with violence. I in no way, I mean, intend any dishonor or disrespect to them and to the incredibly tough job and good job that they overwhelmingly do. I hope we can. You know, it's something that an African-American president, the only two Democrats in our history have been elected and reelected with a majority of the popular vote, Franklin Roosevelt and Barack Obama. I would hope the president, you know, could help initiate and inspire such a conversation.
Do you think it's possible, David?
Yeah, and let's start with the police. I do think it's valid to say their view has not been represented. Like a lot of people in my business, I started as a police reporter in Chicago and spent a lot of time around police. And one of the things that has to be said about them, they spend a lot of their time in extremely unpleasant circumstance mm-hmm. with extremely unpleasant people. Mm-hmm. And they have to wade into that to keep us safe. And God bless them for it. It does often mean that they have a very negative and sometimes a cynical view, an emotional armor they put on about the communities they go into. And I suppose they need that for survival. But it does sometimes lead to a small authoritarianism, if you want to put it, a little bullying sometimes in police behavior. And so, like everything else, the way the police behave, they're human beings. Mm-hmm. And so some of it is incredibly normal and noble, and some of it is brutalizing. And they have sometimes, in some cases, a brutalizing effect on the people they're sort of lording over. It's a human story of good and bad.
Let me turn you both to running the Pentagon. Defense Secretary Chuck Hagel, Mark, steps down this week. He is the third Secretary of Defense in the Obama administration to be leaving the position. They're now looking for a fourth. What does this say? Did Chuck Hagel's experience say about the administration, say about him?
Well, I should acknowledge right up front, I'm a sympathizer, supporter of Chuck Hagel, and have been for a long time. Admired his own service, both to the country politically and publicly, and volunteer in the military to serve as heroically as he did in Vietnam. But Judy, when you're looking for your fourth Secretary of Defense in less than 6 years, which is what this administration is doing, and the previous two, Hagel's two predecessors, both went public with charges of micromanagement from the White House. That Bob Gates, a reasonable man, said it drove him crazy. When Leon Panetta said it's leading to an exclusion of other voices, just a limitation that the president is sort of surrounded by this clique and of very hyper uber loyalists, but with very few other people, that the cabinet is excluded. I think it's a comment on a situation that is serious to the president, and
the situation that he is
in a bubble that is very very narrow, that they're trying to run everything out of the White House. And I think this is a problem that they had, that Gates complained of it, that Panetta complained of it, and it didn't change under Chuck Hagel. And they can fault Chuck Hagel, the president praises him, and then immediately the White House staff starts sniping that he wasn't up to the job, he didn't have the substance, he wasn't proactive, whatever the hell that means. So they immediately accuse the president of dissembling. Their loyalists are suggesting the president was being disingenuous when he praised the president, the secretary, as an exemplary defense secretary.
David?
Yeah, well, each administration over the last 30 years probably has concentrated more and more power in the White House. Mm-hmm. For a long time, most of the other cabinet secretary jobs have been neutered. But it used to be you had the big three, Secretary of State, Secretary of Defense, and Attorney General, had some independent authority. Under this administration, I think even the big three have been severely weakened, none more seriously than Chuck Hagel. There are people who follow this who say he underperformed in certain roles, especially the outside roles. But it's certainly true that he was not consulted in all sorts of policies concerning the Defense Department, that decisions were made in the White House, here and abroad, and then he was told about them later, and he tried to be a good soldier. And so if you're going to hire somebody to be a good soldier, you can't really fault them for not being proactive because you're not giving them anything to do.
So do we look for the next Secretary of Defense to be somebody who very close, already in close with the White House, Mark?
Judy, ironically, the next Secretary of Defense is probably Chuck Hagel. I mean, we've had two. Jack Reed, the senator from Rhode Island, rejected it 30 microseconds after he was floated. Michelle Flournoy, former deputy secretary of defense, said she wasn't interested. I don't know who's going to be and then confirmed.
Quick thought, David.
I agree. They're having trouble because who wants to be a weak person with only 2 years left?
Less than a minute to both of you. It's a day after Thanksgiving. You have to tell me what you're thankful for, Mark, and what you're not thankful for.
Judy, I am thankful for I'm thankful that the American graduation rates in high schools are up dramatically, that our crime rate is down, that people are covered in health care. I'm grateful for the NewsHour.
And not grateful for?
I'm not grateful for David's constant interruption and carping. No. there's nothing I'm not
there's
grateful.
Nothing you're not.
I'm not grateful for.
On that positive note, yeah. David, it's your turn.
I was going to be thankful for Mark Shields, who's been a great partner and friend for many years, but I think I may retract that now. The thing I'm not thankful for is that we don't have 30 minutes on the show, which I think the viewers really demand.
Yeah.
We're stuck like 12 or 14.
You know, I'm going to take that to our executive producer. I think that's a great idea.
Please.
David Brooks, Mark Shields, thank you.
Thank you.